Good morning to St. Peter's family and friends. Welcome to this sixth Sunday after Pentecost and our worship today. We're getting ready to begin worship at 9 o'clock. Tim's going to play a little music so you have a chance to settle in and say hello. We'll see you in a few minutes. Again, good morning and welcome. Our liturgy begins with a hymn from our hymnal, number 440, Blessed Jesus, at thy word. Thank you. Morning again. If you're following along in the prayer book, we begin our service spoken part with the acclamation on page 351. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sin through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Please join me in reciting the Gloria, found on page 356, if you're following in the prayer book. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. O Lord, mercifully receive the prayers of your people who call upon you, and grant that they may know and understand what things they ought to do, and also may have grace and power faithfully to accomplish them, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. And a prayer for the power of the Spirit among the people of God. God of all power and love, we give thanks for your unfailing presence and the hope you provide in times of uncertainty and loss. Send your Holy Spirit to enkindle in us your holy fire. Revive us to live as Christ's body in the world, a people who pray, worship, learn, break bread, share life, heal neighbors, bear good news, seek justice, rest, and grow in the Spirit. Wherever and however we gather, unite us in common prayer and send us in common mission, that we and the whole creation might be restored and renewed, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
A reading from Genesis. This is the account of the family line of Abraham's son Isaac. Abraham became the father of Isaac. And Isaac was 40 years old when he married Rebekah, daughter of Bethuel, the Aramean, from Paddan Aram, sister of Laban, the Aramean. Isaac prayed to the Lord on behalf of his wife, because she was childless. The Lord answered his prayer, and his wife Rebecca became pregnant. The babies jostled each other within her, and she said, "Why is this happening to me?" So she went to inquire of the Lord. The Lord said to her, "Two nations are in your womb, and two peoples from within you will be separated. One people will be stronger than the other, and the older will serve the younger." When the time came for her to give birth, there were twin boys in her womb. The first to come out was red, and his whole body was like a hairy garment, so they named him Esau. After this, his brother came out with his hand grasping Esau's heel, so he was named Jacob. Isaac was 60 years old when Rebekah gave birth to him, to them. The boys grew up, and Esau became a skillful hunter, a man of the open country, while Jacob was content to stay at home among the tents. Isaac, who had a taste for wild game, loved Esau, but Rebekah loved Jacob. Once, when Jacob was cooking some stew, Esau came in from the open country, famished. He said to Jacob, "Quick, let me have some of that red stew. I am famished." That is why he was also called Edom. Jacob replied, "First, sell me your birthright." "Look, I am about to die," Esau said. "What good is the birthright to me?" But Jacob said, "Swear to me first." So he swore an oath to him, selling his birthright to Jacob. Then Jacob gave Esau some bread and some lentil stew. He ate and drank and then got up and left. So Esau despised his birthright. The word of the Lord.
Thanks
be to God. Together let us say the Psalm 119, also found on page 772, verses 105 through 112. Your word is a lantern to my feet, and a light upon my path. I have sworn and am determined to keep your righteous judgments. I am deeply troubled. Preserve my life, O Lord, according to your word. Accept, O Lord, the willing tribute of my lips, and teach me your judgments. My life is always in my hand, yet I do not forget your law. The wicked have set a trap for me, but I have not strayed from your commandments. Your decrees are my inheritance forever. Truly, they are the joy of my heart. I have applied my heart to fulfill your statutes forever and to the end.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Romans. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do because it was weakened by the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fully met in us, who do not live according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Those who live according to the flesh have their minds set on what the flesh desires, but those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their minds set on what the Spirit desires. The mind governed by the flesh is death, but the mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. The mind governed by the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those who are in the realm of the flesh cannot please God. You, however, are not in the realm of the flesh, but are in the realm of the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, they do not belong to Christ. And if Christ is in you, then even though your body is subject to death because of sin, the Spirit gives life because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of his Spirit who lives in you. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our next hymn is from the songbook number 34, One Bread, One Body. The music was included with your email.
Thank you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Glory to you, Lord Christ. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat by the lake. Such large crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat in it, while all the people stood on the shore. Then he told them many things in parables, saying, "A farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places, where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly, because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched, and they withered because they had no root. Other seed fell among the thorns, which grew up and choked the plants. Still other seed fell on good soil, where it produced a crop, 100, 60, or 30 times what was sown. Whoever has ears, let them hear. Listen then to what the parable of the sower means. When anyone hears the message about the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what was sown in their heart. This is the seed sown along the path. The seed falling on rocky ground refers to someone who hears the word and at once receives it with joy. But since they have no root, they last only a short time. When trouble or persecution comes because of the word, they quickly fall away. The seed falling among the thorns refers to someone who hears the word, but the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke the word, making it unfruitful. But the seed falling on good soil refers to someone who hears the word and understands it. This is the one who produces a crop, yielding 100, 60, or 30 times what was sown." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. Last week, I confessed to you a little something of my gardening interests. I particularly, I think, talked about weeding and how I enjoyed going out in the cool of the morning, except like a day like this, and taking advantage of the shade and cool temperatures to be in the garden and yank out some weeds. So this particular gospel has a particular meaning for me and other gardeners, I would expect. We know something about weeds because weeds have a particular relationship with the soil in which they take root. I'm of the opinion that weeds are shallow rooted. That's one way that you can identify them as weeds. Plants that have a more deliberate, shall we say, function in the broader ecosystem take root and find substance far beneath the soil. Not so much with the weeds. And in this particular yard here at the rectory, we have a variety of soil. As you are probably aware, the name Sand Hill Road, on which we find our residence, is named for a rather sandy hill. Those who've been around know well how hard it has been to get the grass around the property of the church to flourish. There are lots of patches of soil or sand. And I can attest, having excavated a chunk of the hillside over at the rectory earlier this spring, that there is indeed a lot of sand around this particular location. But there's also good soil. There are places where it's very fertile and loamy and easy to till, and the plants really thrive in the soil here. There are other places where it is more compact, probably with some combination of clay within it. And parts of the soil likewise have gravel in them, some rocks, but other gravel. And that's a remnant from when the parking lot was laid out and a gravel base was put down. That gravel got pushed in the direction of the lawn of the rectory. So there you have it. More than you ever wanted to know about the soil of our garden over at the rectory. But because I like to weed and because I've been planting things this last spring, I'm very aware of how things are doing in the soil. I'm aware of the things that need closer attention. either to keep weeds from encroaching upon their roots that are trying to become established, whether more water is necessary because the plants themselves are thirsty, or the soil itself is either hard to drain or drains too well, which can happen with sandy soil. I'm very aware, in other words, of how soil impacts whatever it is that seeks to grow in it. Enter the gospel of the today. Soil is really what this gospel is about. The sower, this is known as the parable of the sower, as if scattering the seed is the kind of thing to pay attention to. And yes, if you're a planter, you want to pay attention where you scatter your seed, but that's because you want it to land in good soil. I would imagine in the time of Jesus that farmers and sowers would scatter wherever in the hope that the seed would at some place take root. Much easier to scatter all at once than to figure out where the good soil is, not where the bad soil is. And that all takes time and energy to work out where you're going to take on your harvest or try to create a harvest. So scatter at will, come up what may. But through the course of time, it's evident that where there is thin soil or rocky soil and no place for roots to take perches, plants are not going to find good life. It says fairly clearly in the parable what's at stake for the future of any seed, depending on the soil. Now, today, we're not talking about who we are as gardeners. We are talking about who we are as a metaphor for receivers of God's word. In other words, what kind of soil do we find in our heart and in our mind, even in our life and in our relationships? Do we hold fast to what we think, to what we feel? Do we hold fast and stubbornly to an allegiance to something? Now, stubborn there is not necessarily a bad thing. I think a kind of steadfastness might be a better choice of words. But in all respects, the world assaults us with new thoughts, new ideas, new paradigms, new ideologies, new theories, new everything throughout our days from when we're, you know, an infant to growing up. We take in and process all kinds of information. And somewhere along the line, we sort out what among that information has value and carries truth within it. And there comes a time sometimes, especially in relationships, where we want to feel connected or be connected to particular groups of people who may espouse or hold a different point of view, but because the connection and the relationship is of such importance to us, we put aside our own particular thoughts or feelings if they differ from that group or that entity or organization. There are times when, because of a belief system that we begin to nurture and cultivate through our lifetime, new ideas come in and we think, well, that sounds like there might be truth in it, but it doesn't resonate with what I've always held, a little something called cognitive dissonance. And those kinds of opportunities, which is what they are, actually get at what kind of soil is in our heart and in our mind. Whether or not we end up agreeing with a new idea, the willingness to evaluate it, to test it out, to give it an opportunity to check its merit is a piece of what it means to live and engage in the world and with other people. It's how we grow. Consider for a moment that children find great freedom in getting on a tricycle. They don't stay on the trike. They eventually move on to a bicycle. And some people will move from there into speed bikes or dirt bikes or motorcycles. There's an evolution that comes with knowledge and learning. And a piece of that knowledge and learning and evolution and maturing, if you will, in our hearts and in our minds is also what God invites us into here and now through the words of Jesus. Because even the word of God does not remain the same within us. Consider, it's not a piece of this lectionary today, but consider elsewhere where Paul talks about being new in the faith and needing to drink milk before moving on to solid food. There is a reason that we start with a foundation of ideas and then build on them with specificity and particularity. The Word of God is likewise the same. We've talked from time to time about how a particular passage of Scripture will land in our hearts or in our minds and strike us in a particular way. And then we come back months or even years later, and that same Scripture will take on a different meaning and have a different resonance for us. Because life is not static. We are dynamic individuals. We live in a dynamic world, and the Word of God is dynamic. It comes to us so that we might revisit it and see what new meat we might find within it, what new nourishment we can see that it has to offer where we are. And the soil of our hearts and our minds needs to be in a place where it can receive those words and the words themselves can take root. I want to invite you this day to look at how the Word of God is speaking to you today. Make a note of it, write it down, and perhaps in 3 years, when these lessons come up again in the lectionary, go back and revisit and see what you had to say about today. And at that time, look and see how the Word speaks to you in a new and perhaps different way. It may very well sound exactly the same. Some things come to us as truth in the most pure way, that they won't ever change in their meaning for us, and that's fine. But it is also incumbent upon us as followers of Christ to be open to see how Jesus wants us to look anew, with fresh eyes, hear, with new ears, and see how our faith and our life is deepening in our relationship with Christ and with God. One of the roles of the Holy Spirit, in fact, is to get in and sort of kick up our soil, stir things up so that we might take time and pay attention to how God is moving in us in a new way. Things don't stay the same. We need to be open to recognizing how the Spirit moves within us and among us to illuminate how God's Word may sound different and fresh here and now. Check in with your faith. Check in with the Word of God. Check in with the world around you and see how the world today and God through and in that world might be speaking to you afresh. I suspect if we take the time, each of us, to invest in that small thing, which may take a lot of labor, but it's still a small thing, we'll find that life comes back to us and faith comes back to us and the relationships we have with God and Christ come back to us 30, 60, 100-fold. That is the richest harvest of all and bears the greatest fruit. We continue now with our service in the Nicene Creed, found on page 358 if you're following the prayer book, or near the top of page 5 in the order of service emailed to you. Please join me. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We continue with the prayers of the people, found at the top of page 6 in your order of service, or page 383 in the prayer book. Form 1. With all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the world, for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all peoples, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For Michael, Ian, and Laura, our bishops, for Nigerian bishops John and Marcus, for Anne, our rector, and for all clergy and people, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For our president, for the leaders of the nations, and for all in authority, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this town of South Windsor, for every city and community, and for those who live in them, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the good earth which God has given us, and for the wisdom and will to conserve it, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the aged and infirm, for the widowed and orphans, and for the sick and the suffering, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those afflicted with the coronavirus, especially Fred, their families and communities, for frontline workers and essential employees, for healthcare workers and professionals, especially Robin, Paul, Mark, Adrian, Cindy, Kim, Charisse, Gina, Jen, Lorraine, Kyle, Brian, Carrie, Michael, Megan, Amanda, Saud, Brian, Melanie, Laura, Ken, Sharon, Dave, Austin, Tim, Franny, Ryan, and Tammy, and for their families. For nursing homes, staff, and residents, for all people and communities impacted by efforts to slow the spread of this disease. Lord, have mercy. For Marty, Kathy, the Beck, Borsari, and Ober families, the community of South Windsor High School, Priscilla Pryor, Lynn Merrill, Mark Taylor, Mary Waite, Andrea Newberry, Matthew Wood, and those committed to our ongoing prayers. For the concerns and organizations supported by St. Peter's through mission, especially the Cornerstone Foundation. For members of our armed forces serving at home and abroad, and for their families, especially Kenneth Fraley Jr., Kevin Merrill, and Jason Serra, and for victims of natural disasters and human violence throughout the world, especially those in situations of risk during stay-at-home orders. We pray for persons and communities impacted by centuries of anti-Black bias, and for those seeking to undo the harm of racism. Are there others? Lord, have mercy. In our parish cycle of prayer, we pray for the ministry of the Finance Commission, for parish members, the Lundy, Majewski, and Malone families, and thanksgiving for all who are working hard to figure out how to worship safely in person. And thanksgiving for Molly Frank, Laura Ostrowski, Danny O'Connell, Karen Kubica, Carrie Redinger, Tori Ostrowski, and Sue Grenier, who are celebrating birthdays this week. We join Barbara Hoff and her family in thanksgiving for the birth of her new granddaughter, Morgan Elizabeth Held, born yesterday. We also join Greg and Melissa Frank, celebrating an anniversary this week, and we give thanks for groups to whom we extend hospitality through the use of our buildings, especially Boy Scout Troop 62. For others, we lift up either to God, either silently or aloud. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the poor and the oppressed, for the unemployed and the destitute, for prisoners and captives, and for all who remember and care for them, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the repose of the souls of all those whose lives have been lost as a result of the coronavirus, and for all who have died in the hope of the resurrection, and for all the departed, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For deliverance from all danger, violence, oppression, and degradation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. O Lord, our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. We continue with our last hymn in the hymnal, number 632, O Christ, the Word Incarnate.
Thank you.
Please join me in reciting the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Go out into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Tend the sick. Honor all people. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of God's Holy Spirit, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this day and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. No Zoom coffee hour this week, but this Saturday, weather permitting, we look forward to some time together on the back lawn with our bring your own picnic and chair and bug spray. 6 o'clock. We'll see you then. Thanks for joining us this morning. Have a good day.